Welcome to Untangle, the podcast from Five Star App Meditation Studio. I'm Patricia Karpus, co-founder of Meditation Studio and your host on Untangle, along with my co-host, Ariel Garten, one of the founders of brain sensing headband, Muse. Join us each week as we introduce you to authors, experts, and thought leaders who share their stories on how meditation, mindfulness, and brain-focused practices have the power to change our lives. Whether you're just learning to meditate or want to deepen your practice, Meditation Studio, with hundreds of guided meditations, and Muse, which provides great feedback on your practice, are two awesome tools you'll want to have in your back pocket. Now, on to Ariel and today's interview.
Welcome. This week, we're going to extend beyond our heads to our hearts and get down and dirty on the topic of love. Dr. Helen Fisher is a biological anthropologist who studies love, and she knows a thing or two about love. She's written 6 books on the future of human marriage, sex, love, gender differences in the brain, and how your personality style shapes who you love. She also knows a thing or two about dating. She's been this chief scientific advisor to Match.com for how many years, Helen?
Let's see, 14.
14. You've seen a lot of changes in how people date in that time.
Absolutely.
And so you've seen a lot about how modern technology has or hasn't changed that ritual.
Right, exactly.
So welcome, Helen. We're excited to get inside your head and your heart and learn about love.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here.
Happy for you to be here. So let's dive in first around your Match.com experience, because it's so fascinating to think that you've watched literally millions and millions of people date, fall in love, court, flirt over the last 14 years.
Yeah,
tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I do a lot of things with Match.com. What I've been doing in the last 9 years is we do an annual study called Singles in America about sex, love, dating, orgasm, what they had for dinner, what they're looking for in a partner, how they break up, have they been ghosted, everything. We ask about 200 questions every year. We create the questions in August, and then right before Christmas, all the data comes back. We collect the data on the internet, which is a good way to do it, actually, because people are more honest when they're doing it on the internet. And then we generally go out in mid-February for Valentine's Day and talk about singles in America. What's really important, well, there's much important about what we found, but what's important to remember, though, is that we do not poll the Match members. This is not a poll of Match members. It's a national representative sample of singles based on the U.S. Census. So we got the right number of Blacks, Whites, Asians, Latino, gay, straight, rural, suburban, urban, every part of the country, every age group, age 18 to 71 plus. So it's an enormous study. We collect data on over 5,000 people every year. We're just about to come out with our 9th year results. So we got 40,000 people that we're looking at. And of course, we found an incredible number of very interesting things about singles in America.
Like what? Like what? We all want to know.
One of the ones that really has always interested me is that men fall in love just as often as women do. I mean, I actually have put a lot of people into brain scanners and studied romantic love in the brain. And we see that men's brain, when they're madly in love, is just as active as women's. But in the Singles in America study, we were able to establish that men fall in love faster than women do. They fall in love more often than women do. When they meet somebody, they want to introduce them to friends and family sooner. Men want to move in sooner. Men have more intimate conversations with their wives and girlfriends than women do with husbands and boyfriends, because women have their intimate conversations with their girlfriends. And men are 2.5 times more likely to kill themselves when a relationship is over. So, and in fact, 48% of singles believe that men are just as romantic as women are. It's just our women's magazines and sort of the general public that somehow think that women are more romantic. That's one thing that I really, really like. Gays are just exactly like straights. Every single year, I mean, they fall in love just as often. They fall in love just as hard. They want to move in just as often. They tend to have a little bit more sex outside of the relationship with the agreement of their partner. That's something that's probably pretty well known. But sex, the brain system for sex is different from the brain system for romantic love. And they're just as romantic as straights are. It's a basic brain system. So Those are two things. I'm older, so I like to study older people. They can be very sexual if they've got a partner, and they do not compromise as much. One of the questions that I asked several years is, would you make a long-term commitment to somebody who has every single thing you're looking for in a partner, but you do not find that person sexually attractive? And the least likely to make that compromise and give up the sex is people over 60. It's the young.
Really?
Yeah. And the young are compromising because they've got to. I mean, the young have to find a reproductive partner. And a good example is a young man who's a friend of mine. And he once said to me, he said, you know, Helen, my wife is not the best I've ever had in bed. I've had much better in bed. But she's the right person for me. She's wonderful to our daughter. She's very interested in my business. She's very charming. She's a great partner. And so I went with that. And, you know, during your reproductive years, you've really got to be very careful about who you choose. We all have to be careful about who we choose at any age. But the bottom line is, the older you get, the less likely you are to compromise. And I think I'm in a good example. I mean, I'm way over 60. And
I wouldn't have guessed looking at you.
Oh, you're a sweetheart. Thank you. And I've got a wonderful boyfriend at the moment, but I was single for a long time. And there was a guy in Arizona who I really liked him. He had everything I could want in a man. He loved theater. He was very humorous. He was very well educated. He was good looking. He was kind, but I wasn't interested in him sexually. Am I going to move from New York City at my age to Arizona, where I don't know a single person, to be with somebody who's not a sexual interest as well as everything else? No, I'm not. So the older you get, the happier you are. There's a lot of data about that, not only among in the Singles in America study, but around the world. And I could go on and on and on.
Pick up for 1 second on this idea that people get happier as they get older. I think we've heard this before, but intuitively it doesn't seem to make sense because we think about, you know, grumpy old men. It's such a construct. Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about being happier as you age?
All the data shows that there's sort of two kinds of happiness. I mean, psychologists would say this, just being, you know, that joyful self. And the other is sort of a sense of well-being. And I think as you get older, this sense of well-being gets greater. I mean, you get calmer. I know I'm not as ambitious as I used to be. I don't care if they call somebody else instead of me. I look back over the arc of my life and I'm sort of astonished at the things that I've done. I'm sort of pleased with them. And I do think that the brain becomes more relaxed. People become more relaxed. They've gotten rid of much of the bad in their life and moved on to accept the life that they've got, look at some of their achievements and be happy. I know that older women are very picky in their relationships. Older people are not going to put up with a lot of junk. We've been there, we've done that, and we're not doing it again. And I do think that you see where you've been, you see where you are, you can be very grateful about things. And all of the data show that older people are happier.
Well, thank you for sharing some of that wisdom from a person that I can't consider thinking of as older as I look at you here in the video.
Well, thank you, but I am.
So you've hinted a little bit about what the brain looks like in love. Can you talk about the neuroscience of love, please?
It's interesting. You know, if there's any part of human behavior that would have evolved, that would be seated in the brain, would be all of our reproductive strategy. Because if you have 4 children and I have no children, you live on and I die out. So the game of love matters. So I figured we would have evolved various systems to make sure that we find a partner and have babies. And so I began to look at the brain in love. And there's a lot of characteristics of love that we could talk about. But what happens in the brain is we put 17 people who just fallen happily in love into the brain scanner. And we found activity in a tiny little factory near the base of the brain called the ventral tegmental area, or the VTA. It's a brain region that actually makes dopamine, which is a natural stimulant, creating motivation, ecstasy, focus, wanting. This little VTA sends that dopamine to many brain regions that gives you that craving, the obsession, the focus, the motivation, the ecstasy, and even the anxiety and despair of intense romantic love. So There's all kinds of cognitive processes. I mean, you're always thinking about the person, and there's all kinds of, in the middle of the brain, the limbic regions, like with the emotions, you have a lot of emotions, but basically romantic love is a drive. It comes from one of the most primitive parts of the brain, linked with craving, obsession, motivation, and intense feelings of romantic passion. And in fact, that little brain region lies right next to brain regions that orchestrate thirst and hunger. And thirst and hunger keep you alive today. And feelings of intense romantic love enable you to focus your mating energy on a person, start that attachment, and drive your DNA into tomorrow. So it's a basic survival mechanism that evolved millions of years ago, actually long before we became people. Other animals do feel that animal attraction, but it's very brief. We can do it for years. It's the basic feeling of intense romantic love.
So is that feeling of intense romantic love necessarily a good thing? I mean, we've talked about it as this animal drive, this craving, this obsession. Yeah. When you evolve into a relationship, do you want to keep that feeling throughout your relationship, or can it be harmful?
I think it can be either. I think we've evolved three distinctly different brain systems for mating and reproduction. One is the sex drive. Second is feelings of intense romantic love. And third is feelings of deep attachment. And all three of these brain systems are way at the base of the brain. And in a good relationship, and it's my guess that the vast majority of people want to keep all three brain systems very active. Intense feelings of the sex drive for your partner, intense feelings of romantic love for your partner, and feelings of deep attachment for your partner. But I do think that it can turn into an addiction. A very positive addiction when it's going well, where you've chosen the right person and you're very happy, but a very negative addiction when the person dumps you, when they're cheating on you, when there's abuse, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a very powerful drive. It's a little bit like hunger. I mean, you know, it's great when you're eating the right things at the right time, and not so great when you're, you know, overeating or undereating or eating all the wrong things. So it's basically a drive that evolved millions of years ago. I mean, I think the sex drive actually evolved to get you out there to look at a range of partners. You know, you can have sex with somebody you're not in love with. I think romantic love evolved to enable you to focus your mating energy on just one individual at a time. And that third brain region of attachment enabled you to stick with this person at least long enough to raise a child together through the infancy of a child. So I think they are all very powerful. Evolve for very important reasons, and can be feel a sense of tremendous joy during sex, joy when you feel madly in love, joy when you feel deeply attached, and it can certainly move into horror when things go wrong.
That's fascinating. Can we talk a little bit more about the brain regions around attachment and how those work and how to potentially deepen attachment?
You know, people who have just fallen happily in love do not show a lot of activity in the basic brain region linked with attachment. When we put people into the scanner who had just fallen happily in love, people who had fallen in love in the last 8 months did not show activity in this brain region linked with attachment. It's called the ventral pallidum. But people who had been in love 8 to 17 months did begin to show activity in this brain region linked with attachment. So attachment grows. The sex drive can be instant. Romantic love can be instant, but attachment grows. It grows in the brain.
It's fascinating. So we really do need to nurture our relationships in order to grow and deepen that attachment.
Well, I think that we're, you know, when you're madly in love, you tend to do that naturally. You know, I mean, you just can adore somebody and just, and the attachment grows with them. But, you know, I mean, you can be madly in love with somebody that you don't really ever want to be attached to. I mean, you know, I know all kinds of people, including me, who've fallen in love with somebody and said, oh man, this isn't right. I've never bring this person home to mother. You know, I mean, this is not right. But you're still madly in love with the person. And I mean, that's one of the reasons that casual sex is not casual. Unless you're so drunk you can't remember it, casual sex is not casual. Things happen in the brain. It can, you know, actually any kind of sexual stimulation of the genitals can drive up the dopamine system and push you over the threshold into falling in love. And with orgasm, this can often be a real flood of oxytocin and vasopressin linked with feelings of attachment. So you can hop in bed with somebody and think it's a one-night stand. And then actually we studied this in our Singles in America study at Match. And I asked the question, have you ever just gone into a one-night stand thinking that's a one-night stand, you know? and fallen madly in love with somebody and have it turn into a long-term partnership. And 35% of the people said yes, that it happened to them. And then you get into this friends with benefits. Then you're having regular sex with the person. You're beginning to get to know the person. That amount of sex can really drive you over the edge. And when we asked, 45% of singles had a friends with benefits situation turn into a long-term committed partnership. So these three brain systems, sex drive, romantic love, and feelings of attachment, are connected in the brain, but they're not always connected. And that's the problem. You know, you can lie in bed at night and feel a deep, you know, attachment to one person and then swing into feelings of wild romantic love for somebody else. And then into feelings of the sex drive for somebody you hardly know. So they're very powerful, very basic, very primitive brain systems that are going to be with us as long as we survive as a species. And that's very worthwhile to get to know how you can handle them.
Actually, that's an interesting question, how you can handle them. How yeah. would you suggest people think about their relationship to these systems or manage these systems when they start to take over us?
Let's say you suddenly get bored in a partnership. This is the reverse of what you just asked, but you get bored in a partnership and you want to re-stimulate all three of these brain systems. I think that's not too hard.
Tell us the secrets.
Just have sex. If you want to get more sex drive, have sex. There is testosterone in seminal fluid. Testosterone triggers the sex drive. The more sex you have, the more sex you want. Have sex. Sex is good for you. It's very good for the muscles, the skin. It's very good for the bladder. It's good. It's very good for your sense of humor, actually. It boosts the immune system. Sex lowers the cholesterol. It lowers cortisol, the stress hormone. It triggers brain growth.
Sex triggers BDNF?
It triggers activity in the amygdala for emotional processing, in parts of the prefrontal cortex for decision-making. Sex is good for you. It's good for the body. And if you're getting bored, just think of doing it. You know, set up a schedule, for God's sakes. We schedule when you get a haircut. We schedule when we pick our children up. We schedule things at work. You can certainly schedule some sex. The more you do it, the more you're going to like it. In order to trigger feelings of intense romantic love, novelty, novelty, novelty. Go do novel things together. And in terms of attachment, just stick together. Walk arm in arm. Learn to at least start the night sleeping in each other's arms. Cuddle on the couch while you watch television rather than two separate armchairs. Kiss. Kissing drives up the oxytocin system. Any kind of pleasurable trust will drive up the oxytocin system and give you feelings of deep attachment. So you want to keep the sex drive alive. You want to keep romantic love alive. You want to keep the attachment alive. But we ended up, four other things that really fascinated me to keep relationships in good shape. We put 17 people into the brain scanner who had been married an average of 21 years. They kept on coming into the lab and saying, I'm still in love with her, not just loving, but in love with her or him. So we put these people into the scanner, and sure enough, we found the same activity in the ventral tegmental area and several other brain regions. But we also, among those who were very happy in their partnerships, we found activity in three basic brain regions. Brain region linked with empathy, a brain region linked with controlling your own stress and your own emotions, and a brain region linked with what I call positive illusions, the ability to overlook what you don't like about somebody and focus on what you do. And the very last thing is they've now discovered that say nice things to your partner every day. Not only does that help boost their immune system, reduce cholesterol and cortisol in their body and brain, but it also does it in you. So those seven things: express empathy, control your own stress, your own emotions, overlook the negative, say nice things, get into bed with him or her, do novel things together, and stay in touch. Those are all brain regions. Now, there's all psychologists will say all kinds of psychological things you should do, all good. But what I've tried to do in my work is add what the brain says, about a happy partnership.
That's beautiful. And now we all have a recipe that we can follow. It's so simple.
It is simple, but sometimes it's hard for people. I don't know. It's not hard for me, but.
And when you think about it from the reward perspective, it makes total sense that novelty as upregulating your dopamine system would also cross over and stimulate your VTA.
Exactly.
So some of the things that you described, meditation can actually help you with. So empathy, perspective taking, managing your own stress. So all of those who have long-term meditation practices will recognize these as, you know, meaningful things that meditation does for them.
That's a lovely for me to know, because I certainly do meditate every day, as I mentioned to you, but I didn't know. I mean, I've always known the physiological benefits. I mean, I just feel better. I'm just much more relaxed. I mean, I'm just not stressed. And I get up and I've got renewed energy. And what else do I get from it? I can't remember what you just said.
So, increased empathy and perspective taking.
Okay.
Ability to manage your own stress.
Okay.
Can you talk a little bit about your meditation practice? I know we chatted about it a bit.
Every day I get to a certain point and I got to stop. I got to stop in the middle of the sentence. It's just plain over. And I go lie down. I put a little pillow underneath my head and I put three pillows under my knees. My back is very comfortable. And I get myself nice and warm. And I just do that deep breathing. I almost instantly fall into a state. Well, I feel the mask of the face falling off. I feel the body just falling off the bones almost. And I begin to feel like a cosmic connection with all animate and inanimate things, part of the Milky Way, really. And it happens when I'm not breathing at all, when I completely exhaled. And that's when I begin to feel that cosmic connection and feel this incredible release of body, I suppose you'd call it. And then all of a sudden I catch myself thinking about what I said to somebody today. And then I have to decide, well, do I want to keep thinking about this? It's sort of fun to think about it. Or should I get back into that state? And I will often say, well, let's think about it for a little, have a little fun at that. But that's not relaxing. And then I begin to say, okay, get a grip, you know, get back into the breathing. I start doing the breathing. And almost as soon as I do the breathing, I'm back into that other place. No more Helen, just complete. I don't even know if it's relaxation. It's sort of, I guess, connection. It's not even a thinking process, what it is. It's sort of a being.
It's perfect.
That makes sense.
Totally, utterly perfect. The sense of connection to you and the universe and everything else.
Yeah. You know, once I didn't have time to do it and I was racing out and I got into the tub and I hadn't done it and I was exhausted and I was going to have to go to get all dressed up. I said, okay, Helen, I'm going to do it in the tub. I happen to love really hot baths. So I was in the tub and then I said, I got myself all relaxed in the tub and I started doing the deep breathing and all was just perfectly fine, normal. And all of a sudden I found myself above my body, about 5 feet above my body, looking down, and it was as real as looking at you right now. I looked down and I had two thoughts. The first thought was, oh, Helen, why did you worry so much all of your life? How stupid was that? And then I wheeled around as this sort of ghost of molecules, and I dissolved into like little bubbles, into millions of molecules, and started heading for the Milky Way. And I had this intense feeling of joy, rapture, almost conquering sort of feeling of joy. And then I decided to breathe again and got back into my body and into the tub. But I'll never, ever forget that. And what it gave me is what I think will happen, or at least I'm hoping will happen, that the moment that I die. I mean, I actually look forward to that moment. I don't look forward to old age. I don't look forward to, you know, decrepitude and all of the other things that one would worry about. But the actual moment of death for me might be that. And even if it isn't, it's given me a tremendous amount of relaxation about that moment and perhaps joy in that moment. So it hasn't happened again, but I can remember the feeling so much of it that although I can't see myself above myself 5 feet, the learning about stopping worrying and the learning about the joy and the feeling of those breaking into bubbles and atoms and dispersing, I can remember it in a very joyful way. And I still, when I lie there and do the meditating, I really see the Milky Way, that classic picture that we all see of the Milky Way, and my infinitesimal sort of part of it, and the unbelievable experience of it, for God's sakes. I mean, the Milky Way, and that's only a little one, for God's sakes, is 80 billion of them. It's a lot to think about.
That's incredible. That's a beautiful experience that not many people get to actually have, to get to the point in their practice where they can feel that sense of being out of their body, connected to the world, dissolving into the universe. It's extraordinary.
Well, that's lovely to hear, because I've never had any meditate, and nobody's ever told me how to meditate. I did in graduate school 100 years ago, really. They said how to breathe. You know, I'm an anthropologist, and I went to a shamanic thing one afternoon. They taught you just how to breathe. And, you know, they said, you know, you need a word. And I tried trying a word, but it's easier to just breathe and just get out. Because if I got a word, I got to be doing something. And it's easier for me to just disappear completely.
It's amazing. So as an anthropologist, what do you make of all this?
What do I make of meditation and how that does?
Yeah, and the experience that you had. And
it's sort of amazing that the brain has evolved mechanisms for such peace. How is that selected for? I mean, you know, selection is having babies. Did people who had this experience must have been more relaxed, must have felt more connected, and had more children because they were more relaxed, more connected, more calm, more genuine? And so those babies passed on this brain circuitry. It's probably the only way you could think about it, because there had to have been some selection for it, or we wouldn't all have the experience.
So interesting that in so many traditions, the people who train themselves to have these experiences, monks and nuns, choose to not have babies.
That's pretty modern, though. You know, we didn't have monks and nuns a million years ago. That's very modern. The brain was, you know, we have exactly the same brain as we had 300,000 years ago. The organization of the brain, the neurochemicals of the brain, the structure of the basic structure of the brain has not changed in 300,000 years. And of course, we came down out of the trees 4.4 million years ago. So that's a lot of time to have babies to pass this tradition on.
To select for this state. Yeah.
And even shaman had children. And, you know, I mean, maybe shaman in past centuries and millennia had a deeper connection. Maybe they did get into a trance state more often. I don't know much about trance. But maybe I don't know anything about trance, but they certainly would have had just as many children as everybody else. In fact, even more, because they had a special practice, which was curing. So it's good. We're working something out here. I never thought of this before in my whole life.
It's awesome. So I know one thing you do think a lot about is different kinds of personalities and how they impact how you act and who you love.
Yes, I do.
Can you dive into personality for a bit?
I would love to, because this is my newest work. It started in 2005 when Match.com came to me, was the CEO on down. And he asked me in the middle of the morning, why do you fall in love with one person rather than another? And I said, I don't know. Nobody knows. We do know that you tend to fall in love with somebody from the same socioeconomic background, same general level of intelligence, same general level of good looks, same religious and social values. Your childhood always plays a role. We build an unconscious list. I call it your love map of things you're looking for in a partner. And you keep altering that during your childhood and adulthood. All of that plays a role. But you can walk into a room and everybody's from your background and same level of intelligence and good looks, and you don't fall in love with all of them. So I began to think to myself, could basic body chemistry pull you naturally to one person rather than another? I looked through all the academic literature, the last, say, 40 years of it, for any trait at all linked with any biological system. Now, there's all kinds of systems in the brain, as you know, as a neuroscientist. But most of them keep the eyes blinking and the heart beating. They're not linked with personality traits, but there are four that are the dopamine, serotonin, testosterone, and estrogen systems. And these four brain systems are each one of them linked with a constellation a list of personality traits. So I created a questionnaire to see to what degree you express the traits linked with these four brain systems, dopamine, serotonin, testosterone, and estrogen. I put that questionnaire on Match and on chemistry.com, a related site, a Match site. 14 million people have taken this questionnaire, and I can watch who's drawn to whom. And as it turns out, those people were very high on the dopamine system. I call them explorers. Now, we're a combination of all of them. I mean, these are not cubby holes. They're brain systems. We have ratios, of course.
I'm a dopamine system.
Oh, yes. You're the dopamine system. I think you're also the estrogen system. I think you're
I agree with that. Yep.
And I think that's what I am too. Because it's funny, I'm beginning to feel somebody, you know, and I felt that instantly. So people who are very expressive of the dopamine system tend to be risk-taking, novelty-seeking, curious, creative, spontaneous, energetic, mentally flexible, and they're drawn to people like themselves. High dopamine explorers go for people like themselves. They want somebody with the same energy, curiosity, creativity as them. People are very expressive of the serotonin system. I call them builders. Not a great term, but I've got it now. We've got 14 million people who've taken it. I'm stuck with it. So I think I would have called them guardians if I'd known more better. They're traditional, follow the rules, respect authority, concrete thinking, tend to be calm, tend to be social, tend to be religious, like rules, schedules, plans. And they are drawn to people like themselves as well. Traditional goes for traditional. America's Vice President, Mike Pence, is a perfect example. In those two cases, similarity attracts. In the other two cases, opposites attract. High testosterone, I call the director, goes for high estrogen, the negotiator, and vice versa. So people are very high testosterone. Steve Jobs is a perfect example. Einstein was a perfect example. These people are analytical, logical, direct, decisive, tough-minded, good at what we call rule-based systems, everything from mechanics, engineering, computers, math, music. I think Beethoven was high testosterone. And they go for their opposite of the high estrogen. High estrogen people, I think actually Hillary Clinton is very high testosterone. I think Margaret Thatcher was high testosterone. Women can be it, but there's many more men in that category. High estrogen people, negotiators, they see the big picture. They're contextual, holistic, synthetic, long-term thinkers. They can deal well with ambiguity. They've got a very good imagination. They've got good people skills, reading posture, gesture, tone of voice. They're nurturing. They're trusting. They're empathetic. And they're emotionally expressive. And they go for the high testosterone, their opposite. So me, for example, my boyfriend is very high dopamine, just like me. He's a well-known writer. You got to be bit creative if you're going to do any writing. And he's a risk-taking guy. He's been all over the world, et cetera, et cetera. So we're both high dopamine. That works. He's high testosterone and I'm high estrogen. And that also works. In that case, we're both very, it's perfect. He's a little bit higher in the serotonin scale, the traditional, than I am. Bottom line is he's much better at making all of our plans. So, you know, it's, I have studied 100,000 people. I've never met two people who I thought were alike. They were all different. And even my twin sister, I've got an identical twin sister, even she and I are not exactly alike. No two people are exactly alike. But there's patterns to nature, there's patterns to culture, and there's patterns to personality. And that's what I think I've stumbled on, some basic patterns of personality. And they've really, I mean, I wrote a whole book on it called Why Him, Why Her, but, and my most recent book, it's in that, it's actually, the questionnaire is in two of my books. It's all over the internet too. But anyway, it's called the Fisher Temperament Scale, if anybody wants to take it. Well, that's the original one. The one that I had offered you is the newer, fancier one. It's really helped me actually in my personal life, as well as intellectually, academically.
It's interesting. So when I heard you first describe this scale, I immediately identified my husband as high testosterone and also high in dopamine as well. You know, like, we're both novelty seekers. Myself is very high dopamine and also high estrogen. And It entirely explained why he will tell me something once and very short and to the point, and I want to tell him something long and, you know, flowery, and he gets mad that I'm describing something. He's like, you told me this already. You could have told me in the first two words. I'm like, I just want to share what's on my mind. I just want to share my thoughts and my feelings. He's like, you shared it already. Thank you. It's like, whoa, that is clearly a testosterone versus estrogen system.
Yes, it is. And what do you do? And how do you feel?
It's an issue. It's like, okay, then somebody with an estrogen being feels like they are not being fully heard. And somebody with a testosterone being feels like somebody is constantly repeating themselves. And why is this repetition happening?
You know, I often say it this way, that, you know, you feel evaded and he feels invaded.
Invaded. Yes.
And last night it happened with me and my boyfriend. I was going over an issue and he finally said, I'm tired. We got to go to sleep. And I said, all right. It's over, you know. But I've learned to say things only once. How are you going to handle it?
You handle it like you handle anything else, through compassion, understanding, finding a middle way, analyzing in yourself what this desire is to repeat something over and over again, you know, analyzing if that's actually what's happening or not. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to figure out the vagaries of human interaction.
And does he realize what he's doing?
I think so.
I mean,
but to him, it's just like, this is the way the world should be. And to me, this is the way my world feels.
Right, exactly. So, you know, I mean, neither is bad or good. They're just different.
Yes.
You know, you've hit a very important point. There's a lot of great psychology in the world. Absolutely wonderful. But right now in America, and I would guess also in Canada, everybody thinks everything is psychological. Everything is a problem with your mother. Everything has to do with your childhood. Everything has to do with your growing up. It's not all that. It's sometimes it's what you inherited. It's who you are. I just want to get people realizing that you don't have to be on a couch for 30 years to understand your personality, to realize what you just described. That's who he is. And it's who you are. Men want to be needed. Women want to be cherished. Men want to be needed. And I think actually right now, you know, asked about what have I learned. I don't think our culture understands either sex, to be honest with you. I don't think they understand men at all, and I don't think they understand women. I think that they think that men are too tough and that women are too untough. I think women are very career-oriented, and I think men want to be needed around the home, et cetera, et cetera. So I don't want to get on a soapbox about it, but I don't think we understand either sex, and I do hope that this understanding of personality can really be of use, not only in the home and with friends, but also in business. And in fact, I give quite a few speeches now and talk about how these four broad styles of thinking and behaving innovate, how they lead, how to build a team. I mean, one of the problems in building a corporate board, for example, is that people invite people like themselves because they understand them. I mean, I'm all for hiring different genders, different sexual orientations, and different ethnic varieties, but you still might be hiring a person with exactly the same brain. Whether you're Black, white, Asian, Latino, you may still be a builder, still be high serotonin. I'm really for diversity of mind in if you're going to build a team or build a corporate board or understand how to sell. What I've really done, what I've stumbled on, is Mother Nature's two basic behavioral patterns. The degree to which you show the traits of men, male versus female, and the degree to which you show the stay versus go. Dopamine is go, serotonin is stay. I'm not studying the American brain, I'm studying the human brain. For example, in China and Japan, there's many more high serotonin people. They're just genetically more high serotonin people in those two countries. I've got data on 40 countries, and you can look at it and see the composition of the styles of thinking and behaving.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, it is. It's captivating to me for sure.
So we've talked a lot about love between presumably two people within a pair and a couple. When we talk about loving other humans who are strangers, when we talk about projecting, you know, love to people all around the world, to feeling the sense of, you know, connection or support or desire to love one another, how do you think about that?
I think that's, I mean, these three brain systems, sex drive, that's not going to be involved. Feelings of intense romantic love, probably that's not going to be involved. But I think that if the love of your pet, for example, love of your children, love of your neighbors, a love of people in other, it probably is somehow linked with the attachment system in the brain. Complicated cognitive things about, you know, people will be involved. But probably the feeling is a feeling of deep attachment, connection, inclusion.
Because when we think about, you know, in a meditation context, often at the end of a meditation, you'll send love to everyone in the world.
Nice. That's very nice. So funny because, you know, I think because I'm an identical twin, I always felt a natural connection to everybody. I mean, you know, maybe that has given me sort of a lifelong connection to other people. I mean, for example, I'll walk through, the American Museum of Natural History in New York, and I'll see little amulets and this and pieces of gold and things. And I'll think, maybe 20,000 years ago, somebody gave that to somebody.
Yeah.
Loved somebody, you know, and I read poetry from around the world, which I think is a great artifact of the human mind. And you can almost feel the way somebody, the anguish or the craving or the obsession or the joy of people everywhere. I mean, these are such basic feelings. I mean, I've actually been to 108 countries, and I tell you, people are exactly alike when it comes to love.
There's potentially this notion that love can save us. And when we think about love saving us, I think it's not just the love between one another, but it's the love between, you know, people and strangers, the love that can overcome hate, the love and the ability to see somebody and like see who they are as a human and feel this, you know, kindness, connection, attachment for their humanity, regardless of whether or not you know them.
I've once read that dappled cows were prejudiced against brown cows, and that, you know, you always hear about the black sheep and the ugly duckling. And we do have mechanisms in the brain linked with, you know, self and other. And for millions of years, you know, other people could be very dangerous. So we do have natural patterns of mistrust until we get to know somebody. And what's, I think, might save the world is that through television and the internet, we're beginning to see people, fall off their bicycle in Iran or you know, play a game of cards in Tibet and see a baby cry in Japan. And once you get more familiar with other people and see that they behave the way you do and that they laugh the way you do and they cry the way you do and they write the same kind of poetry. So I think the more that the world mixes, perhaps those brain mechanisms that cut people off for Darwinian evolutionary reasons will subside and we will feel more of a cosmic connection to all of them.
It's interesting. I mean, you're seeing that in mixed marriages. Yes. There was the social taboo against a mixed marriage, whether it was religious or, you know, cultural.
Right.
And now you're seeing, you know, my husband is Filipino. We have this adorably cute Filipino Jewish baby. And so that thing that really was a mental and a cultural taboo has, within a very short period of time, like a generation or two, really started to dissolve.
And in fact, the internet's really helping with that. We found that there are two payoffs from it. And one of them is more interracial marriages. We're having more interracial marriages because people are meeting people on the internet as opposed to in their social circles. And they get to know somebody because they have the same interests rather than the same color. That you're a perfect example where we're seeing the melding of culture. We're seeing the melding of ethnic groups and seeing the melding of ideas. And that's great. We'll never really get together until somebody from another universe comes to try to bomb us. Then everybody's going to be their best friend. So hope that doesn't happen. I hope we grow up before that.
That we don't need a super other to connect us all to the people around us anyways. Right. If you have one last tip or insider thought around the brain, the love, the human, what would it be?
Any understanding of the today or the future must take into consideration one of the most powerful brain systems that ever evolved, the human drive to love.
Awesome. This has been amazing. Thank you so much for letting us inside of your brain, showing us the inside of our brains on love, on attachment, on sex, on drives, on connection. Thank you for your wisdom.
Well, thank you for having our chat. Have a good day.
My pleasure.
That was Dr. Helen Fisher. You can find all of her resources, more information, and the awesome personality test that tells you exactly which hormone group you're dominated by. You can find it on her website, helenfisher.com. If you'd like to see the full conversation, you can find that on my website, arielgarten.com.
And if you've ever wondered what goes on in your brain while you meditate, and you actually want to hear or see that in real time, you can check out Muse, the brain sensing headband that helps you meditate. It gives you real-time feedback on your meditation practice to let you know when you're focused and when your mind is wandering to help you start or enhance your practice. You can find out more at choosemuse.com. And if you're curious, you can use the discount code UNTANGLE15. Till next week, keep your neurons sparkling and your heart and head filled with love.